Well, hello, 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 and welcome once again to 25 O'Clock. I'm your host, Dan Drago. Thanks for being here. Thanks for joining me on the show. Here we are, Philadelphia's longest-running music podcast. I think I've said that a lot in press over the last month or so, and no one's come back at me yet. We are here. We are the longest-running Philadelphia music podcast, I think. Anyway, welcome to the show. On the show this week, Brian Walker. Those of you who've listened to the show throughout the years know that Brian is no stranger to being on this show. I dig him a lot. He's a very, very creative, very, very prolific singer-songwriter, plays under the name A Day Without Love. And we talk about some of his music, but mostly what we talk about this time around is a documentary that he's going to be putting out at the end of July. It's called Safe and Sound. And we talk about that at great length. And we'll talk more about Brian and his projects and what he's got going on in just a moment. But as always, if you're new to the show, old to the show, medium to the show, I highly recommend you check out 25oclockpod.com. That's the website. That's the place to go out there in the internet world for this show. You can get everything there. All the episodes are available for streaming and for downloading. You can hook up with us on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram. You can sign up for the mailing list. I send out a mailer every time there's a new show. I send out an email, that is, not a mailer. I don't do like direct mail, although I suppose I could. But anyway, I do an email every time that there's a new episode. So if you want to stay up to date on that, sign up for the mailing list and check out the Friends and Neighbors page. That's where I link anyone and everyone who's ever been on the show. So if you like what you hear, you like an artist, you like a person, you want more information, go to that Friends and Neighbors page and get more information. Do it all, 25oclockpod.com. Before we get to Brian, I do want to thank everyone who reached out to me about episode 200 and all the press and sort of things that have been ramping up around it. It's been quite an undertaking, quite a ride to go on for, especially for me. I've never really sought to seek out that much attention for the show. If that sounds weird, but it's very true. I've never wanted to have it be as much about me as it has been over the last month and a half. And I thank everyone who reached out, everyone who sent me an email, everyone who told me they heard the show, the interview with Helen Light at episode 200. Thank you, everyone, for reaching out and for supporting the show and for being into it. And as I said in many interviews, because people always ask, well, what are you going to do after episode 200? And the most obvious answer is also the correct one. Well, I'm going to do episode 201. And that's where we are right now, episode 201 with my friend and colleague, Brian Walker. Let's talk about Brian for just a minute here. Like I said, he plays under the name A Day Without Love. You can check him out at adaywithoutlove.com and adaywithoutlove.bandcamp.com. He's got a new poetry book out called Surviving and Diving. You can get that at his website. And he has an upcoming documentary. It's called Safe and Sam. He shot it on his 2019 Storytellers Tour. It was filmed by Brianna Spouse, who has her own production company. It's called BS Productions. And that's where you can get a lot more information about the film, bsproductions.com/safesoundfilm. And trailer is out right now. It's on YouTube. And the whole thing is going to get released July 27th. And I will probably circle back around to remind you all of that as we get closer to July 27th. But it was a great talk. I hadn't done a full-length talk with Brian in quite some time. So it was good to chat with him. We were of course in our own separate areas. Weren't able to meet in person, but who knows? That kind of stuff is going to be happening soon here on the show. I'm going to get back into the world of sitting in a room with people for real. Slowly but surely. Got to work out some logistics on that and very much take it on a person-by-person basis. But look forward to that. Coming up soon at 25 o'clock, a return to in-person interviews. But anyway, this was a great talk with Brian. You should check out the trailer to Safe and Sound. It's very, very cool. The documentary is going to be outstanding. His music is great. His writing is great. So let's get to it. Let's get to my conversation with Brian Walker here on 25 o'clock.
Fire.
We'll just get right into it, though, because I watched the trailer. I think I watched it when you sent it to me originally, but that was like a month or so ago, or longer. Who knows? Time's irrelevant now, and will continue to be. I watched it again today to kind of reacquaint myself with it, and it's shot beautifully. It looks fantastic.
Thank you.
So, what was the original impetus to, film? Because you started off just, you were going to film your storyteller's tour in 2019, right?
Correct. So, Brianna and I already had, a creative relationship as is, because we met through a mutual friend, and she kind of was, my go-to promo photographer. And she had a photo shoot with me out, way out there, by Doylestown. And she drove me around and she was like, yo, it's always been my dream to follow a band and make a documentary. And I was like, well, as an artist, there's a series of, documentaries I want to make. I might not be a band of, four people, five people, three people, but I would like to have someone follow me around and make a documentary. So she's like, let's talk about that. So we went out to dinner and we talked, and I gave her more information, and I told her about how on YouTube currently, at the time, I was meeting people that I met on tour and interviewing them, right? So I said, what if I did a documentary version of that where I'm interviewing people about their experiences, about their community and playing music? So we kind of just booked this tour, full East Coast, South, and Midwest tour for 18. Yeah, it was 17 shows. It was 17 days and 18 shows, because we did one day that was a two-a-day in North Carolina on St. Patty's Day. And we ended up interviewing people about culture, consent, and diversity and inclusion, about how music spaces and music communities serve as a place for safety and progressive thought. So it wasn't kind of we're going in with this intent. It was more so this is kind of what the common thread was as we started talking to people and meeting them. So, the story in a very honest and truest sense kind of wrote itself. So that's kind of how the content of the documentary came to be.
So you already had sort of the larger arc of the narrative in your head when you guys were going out and filming, right?
Yeah, but it was very broad. It was just culture, music, how does it relate? Everything else kind of just started writing itself.
And did, was it in your head even at the beginning that it was going to be some sort of larger full-length thing and not just a bunch of smaller videos? Or did you go out thinking well, we'll make a bunch of small videos and I can kind of dole them out as I feel?
In my head, I kind of just was thinking just put this on YouTube. I don't care what people think. That's kind of what I was thinking. And then,
that's Brianna, the story of your life right there, though, right? Pretty much.
Yeah, essentially. So that's kind of how I thought about it. And then Brianna was like, no, we need to edit this, produce this, put this to film festivals and stuff like that. So, yeah.
Oh, good. It sounds great. It sounds like she's that other half of the partnership is just no, let's not just spew it out into the world. Let's refine this. Let's shape it. Let's have a intended thing when it's done. It's good to have people like that in your camp who are just no, don't just put out a 3-minute video. Make a thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's awesome. Good for her. She's a good influence.
Yeah. And then we also have Alex Danila editing. So, and you know who he is. He's been on the show. So yeah.
He and I have talked about collaborating again, some sort of podcasty interviewee type thing.
Cool. That's awesome.
He's he's as busy as you are over there, in Lebanon, PA, which is always wild. I joke with him sometimes when I talk to him online. I was just never leave Lebanon. I'm even if you want to, I'm you have to be the guy there, man. I was who else is going to be the guy in Lebanon,
true,
PA?
True.
It's not if he were to leave, someone would immediately take his place. No one would take his place.
True. No, that's not wrong.
I think one of the biggest things that I took from just in the trailer, and then reading some of the material that you guys had written about this, is that there is a very huge difference between playing in clubs and venues and playing these house show DIY type of spaces. I figured we could talk about that. You and I have talked about this before, both on record and off. that I think you and I are of the same mindset, where neither of us really like the rock club format, even like even good rock clubs. Like in the end, I'm still like kind of, eh, what if there was a better way to do this?
I completely agree. And see, that's a perfect example of something that like a lot of people talked about in the documentary, but that wasn't like intended. So that's why I say the documentary kind of wrote itself. And yeah, I would agree, especially after playing at Grace Ferry Skate Park yesterday. Like, there's definitely something very community and organic about being able to play a show, and then after you're done your set, a lot of strangers are hugging you and giving you handshakes and talking to you about their feelings, versus, like, versus like playing a rock club and like someone tells you like you have to go back to the green room and you have to have a merch person order your merch, and then like you disappear, and like, you know, I'm an extrovert and I don't like that. So yeah, among all the other like weird rules of venues, and that's definitely covered in the documentary.
The rock club model is like just one way of doing this.
Yeah.
Certainly not the only one, but because like it's the version that proliferates the most.
Yep.
People think that like, and people in bands, starting out bands, thinking like, well, I guess I got to play clubs. Maybe that's less so the case now, but certainly for me when I was starting out, when I was younger, we were just like, well, I guess we have to play these clubs. Like that's how this works.
Yep. That's definitely true across the states. You know, a lot of people thought like it has to be one way, but you know, music's definitely a pick your own journey sort of thing, you know? So, yeah.
For me, it was getting into like where I grew up, like the regional like hardcore and punk scene and all that, and realizing that like, oh, these shows can't happen in clubs. There's no club that will book this. So these people turn around and you go to VFW basements and church basements and like weird outside shows at like someone's house. You get there and like you don't even know whose house it is, but you're just like, all right, well, someone's parents are gone, so I guess we're having a hardcore show out back. It's just that's such a key thing to talk about, and I like that that's sort of a main through it's going to be a main through line in the documentary, because you live and breathe DIY and have definitely you've definitely shown a light on a lot more things than even I was aware of, and it's happening all over. It's happening everywhere you go. You played 18 shows. You played in like a dozen different states, and you were able to find like some sort of DIY or home, like house based show that wasn't in a commercial venue, that wasn't in a club.
Yeah, we played art spaces, art based bars. We played in art gallery. We played in coffee shops. We played even in a clothing store. We played at a Food Not Bomb space. And other people's homes. So yeah, it definitely was diversified about the different, like the places that we played were very much diversified. So yeah.
How do you dial into that network? I mean, I know how you can, but like in generally, like when people think about like, well, yeah, I'd like to play, you know, these other kinds of spaces. I'd like to, you know, play an art gallery, you know, play an art space, but it's hard enough to book regular clubs, much less like try and find these, you know, alternative spaces. How did you kind of dial into that?
You know, I'm trying to think of it reverse because I'm so far deep in the hole. You know,
yeah.
I would definitely say you want to look using resources like DoDIY.com, because like DoDIY is just like this website that like is literally a library of those resources across the states and parts of the world too. Like if you wanted a tour in Japan, you could like find resources in Japan, things like that. Another resource is Bandcamp, because you could listen to bands. And I think the best cheat is like find a band, look at the last time they released a record, and that's how you can determine how active they really are.
Yeah.
And then reach out to them and just be like, yo, where are you playing in that respective town? And then go from there. And then thirdly, I would just say, like, use Twitter hashtags. Like, if you just say, like, DIY Louisville, DIY Memphis, DIY, like, you'll start seeing people post shows, and then you'll find the flyers. So, yeah.
That's cool. That's cool. Because I know, I mean, like, that's, it speaks so much to, like, that era that, you know, you read about in the 1980s of, like, you know, what would later become alternative music, but was just essentially a DIY network of spaces, bands, record labels, magazines, distribution, like all completely separate of the mainstream, because again, the mainstream had absolutely no interest in it. So like, why would you even bother with them? Why would you try and play like the big club when you're just like, they're not going to book us anyway. And even if they are, they're not going to be happy like financially with what they get from us. So no. we might as well just do this our own way. And of course, you know, that got co-opted into the 90s and made part of the mainstream, but that's how, you know, that's how these things go.
Yep.
No, that's great. And then those are really cool resources that you just listed out right there. I wish they'd existed, or maybe they did exist. I wish they existed more easily back in my day when I was touring more often. Because I always enjoyed the not club spaces that we played. Like I just had such a great time.
It's easier.
Absolutely.
Like it's so much easier. Like granted, we did play a few bars. Even those bars were like kind of like the alternative bar. Like we played in Sarbez in St. Augustine, Florida. And, you know, that's like a flagship stop for DIY artists. It's like, if you see a punk band that says they're going on tour and they say they're playing in Florida, like, chances are you're going to bet, oh, they're playing at Sarbez, because, like, it literally has, like, rules, like, keep your hands to yourself, don't get too drunk, you know, be safe in the mosh pit, stuff like that. Like, stuff that you would see at, like, a house show, but it's at a bar, so.
That's so interesting. It's like a bar. It's like a regular just commercial entity right there, but it's like... It's like the cool kids bar. It's like the art kids bar.
Exactly. Yeah.
And when you think of Florida and like playing in a bar, like immediately just in my head, like I don't want to do it. But
yeah. But no, it was very relaxed. It wasn't like the bro culture that you would think of Florida. So yeah.
Yeah. Well, good for them. Good for them. You got to have it everywhere. I mean, it's in all these little places. That place probably does quite well within its own little. Within its own world, yeah.
Yeah.
You're like going into the South, you're going in the Midwest, you're rolling all around. It's just you and Brianna in your car, right?
Yep. Yeah, that's pretty much what the tour was. Like and then just, you know, merch and snacks.
You can do it lean too. Like if I mean, because you're both singers. So, I mean, she's singer-songwriter too, right?
No, well, she can sing, but she's not like a songwriter. She did perform with me on some songs throughout tour, but most of the time she was pointing and shooting.
Oh, great! Well, that would explain why you have so much footage to go with. Because if she's not concerned with also playing a set too, and like all the things that go in getting ready for a set and then coming off the set. Did you find that this particular tour that you went on was this different than some of the others you've gone on? Because I know you had done a little bit of getting out there beforehand.
I would say it was different and not different, because like prior to that tour, I came off of a week tour like a month ago. And then like after that tour, I literally had like 3 more 2-week tours, you know, month to month. But it was different mostly because we had the camera equipment. And we were actively asking people, like, what does music mean to them and their community? Or, you know, what does a safe space mean to you? Or why do you feel comfortable here versus a bar? So, like, those questions, like, if you were to put on a scale of 1 to 10, they're not, like, they're, like, a level 5 invasive. Meaning that, like, they're not, like, the most personal question, but, like, it could open up doors to more personal questions. So some people are answering like via notepad, because we had that at the merch table, and saying some really ridiculous things. But some people said some very like genuine things about like how music has helped them and created a place called home. So I could say like the tour was different. It definitely was it was my third tour with a car, because at the time I had bought a car and I had traditionally just been touring throughout the United States via Megabus, like up and down the East Coast. And this time I was traveling, like, you know, with my hybrid car. So that was different. It also was different because, like, we had a Sheet sponsorship and a Kind Bar sponsorship.
I remember the Sheet sponsorship. That was so wild.
Yeah. So, like, you know, they didn't give us any rules, but we did agree to, like, you know, promote them on social media for giving us perks. Like, Kind Bar, like, that worked out because I literally just met a marketing brand ambassador. And I was just like, hey, could you give us some Kind Bars like to support our tour? she's like, yeah, just give us a shout out and we'll retweet you. So like, that's exactly what I did. And like, we probably got 80 kind bars, you know, and for two people,
that's a lot, like, of kind bars.
That's way too many. So like, we started giving it out to people at tour, like, yo, if you don't want merch, at least take a kind bar from us, you know? So like, we had that. And then like, Sheetz, they gave us about like $100 worth of gas, and like, keep in mind, I have a hybrid car. So hybrid car plus gas plus tour, like, I was holding on some money, so that was really cool, and that was different. And they gave us about $50 worth of food vouchers. So, like, that curved a lot of costs. It also helped out a lot because between Brianna and I, we had a lot of connections for places to sleep in the cities and towns we went to. So there wasn't too much hoteling or hosteling. It was just, like, friends from college and family members and stuff like that. So that was pretty cool.
That's how a DIY tour is supposed to go, really. Like, you just figure out a way to work lean, and then you figure out a way to like cut out all these extra costs right there. It's just so funny. It's like $100 in gas and $50 in food from just like one place. And you're just like, oh, well, boom, that kind of cuts out like a chunk of tour right there. And if you think about it, you're just like, it's that simple. Like, it's, you don't need a ton of money and resources to go out and do that. But there's, you know, every little bit helps. Anything that can kind of shave something off the bottom line. Do you think a lot of artists that go out there and like, you know, tour in that way, do you think they're thinking of stuff that way as well?
No. I mean, because like, I've been on about 20 tours, and like, I think I've learned something new every tour. And I think the whole idea of sponsorship, I got that from this band called Pocket Vinyl. They're from Connecticut, and they currently hold the world record for the fastest DIY tour ever. They did a full US tour in 44 days. And like, I have this YouTube interview with them about like, how do you tour? And they said like, you know, we get like independent food brands to sponsor us, and in exchange, they do like social media promotion, but like, they get those like consumable, packageable goods. So like coffee, you know, everybody drinks coffee when they're on tour, you know, noodles, like, you know, noodles you could take in anyone's house that you play at and just boil them, as opposed to eating. You got to always factor in your days that you're going to spend money because, like, you want to try Chicago deep dish because who doesn't? You know, stuff like that. So, like, getting the sponsorships are, like, always really important. And, I mean, I remember when I first mentioned it, the only person, like, local affiliate that talked to me that was, like, I recognize the sponsorship game is Adam from Vita and the Wolf.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, because, like, his project, they got Doc Martin sponsorship, and I also think they got a Polar seltzer sponsorship.
Oh, really? There you go. You drink a lot of seltzer on tour, too.
And I do drink a lot of seltzer. So, like, that's something I, like, plan to pursue. I just always kind of think of it like, the more things you can do yourself and get support on yourself, the better supported your tour is going to be. And, like, something I'd like to do in the long run is, like, see what local brands would help, like, acts tour, like, you know, a La Cologne / Philly musician tour would be really cool. So that's just like an idea. But
yeah, no, that's cool. Yeah, and like, because you've got a lot of your day open up to you when you're on tour. Like, it's really all about like playing that like 40 minutes or an hour, that one point at the end of the day. And especially if you have a band in a van or something like that, and everyone's got their phones and everything, it's like, yeah, what else are we gonna do but like make silly videos of ourselves? And you might as well like throw something up on the internet and see if you can get sponsorship. Do you ever think that sometimes people, like, when they hear sponsorship, they might bristle and just be like, oh, that's not the ethos? But like, that's kind of a wrong way to think about it.
I think it's a wrong way to think about it, because you got to think to yourself, if they say that's not the ethos, then why would you fight to be on a record label that takes your money? So, yeah, like, yeah. I've officially given up on the idea of being on a label. Like, granted, I used to be on a label a couple years back. I just think of it like, whether you want to admit it or not, you're a business. You don't necessarily have to be a capitalistic driven business, but you're still a business that's, like, trying to make sure that you can get by gig to gig. And, like, food is something we all eat, capitalist or not, you know? And, like, if you could find a food or beverage brand that's willing to support your music via some packaged goods take that offer, you know? Like, for example, I like Propel, and like, if Propel could give me all the water, by all means, let's do it. You know what I mean? Like, I'm kind of honestly shocked not enough DIY bands are hitting up PBR. Like, I don't drink anymore, but I know if I became a drinking man again, I would definitely try to be a PBR band. Like, Philadelphia has a lot of local beer, right? And yeah. I remember a long time ago, I played a gig for Rock to the Future, and Victory sponsored it. If Victory sponsored, like, music education, why wouldn't they sponsor a band? You know what I mean? Or, you know, Lion's Head, that's another Pennsylvania beer. Yingling. The list goes on. But the point is, like, I'm pretty sure there's a local beer that would be willing to sponsor a Philly band.
Someone could do, like, a series, like, over the course of a couple of months and, like, play at a different brewery, like, all the time and just, like, go around from brewery to brewery and have it be, like, the Philly brewery tour. I mean, you couldn't do it, like, every day in a row, but, like, you just, like, once a week you play at a different brewery. And not even, like, the big ones, like, you know, like Yards and Victory. Yeah. I mean, those are good. But, like, there's, like, little ones, like ARS, which is down by me on West Passyunk. Like,
yeah.
I don't know if you can fit a band in there. They operate very leanly. They don't have a ton of room. But
sure.
Like, that would be an interesting thing right there.
I think it could definitely work. So
yeah. I guess at the core of that, at the core of the idea of sponsorship is like the idea that any idea is worth pitching somewhere. And the worst that can happen is that they're just like, yeah, we don't do that. Or no, we're not interested. So you're like, okay, cool.
And I mean, I definitely think it exists, like... DePinto supports bands a lot. Like,
oh,
it doesn't necessarily have to be a beer brand. Like, DePinto will definitely support a band doing really cool stuff that they like. So
as you travel around and you talk to all these people and you ask the level 5 invasive questions, which I love that terminology right there. what were sort of like some of the really common answers that you were getting, or like, so you talked about a couple of the common threads right there, which was that like DIY spaces, people feel safer, they just feel more comfortable in, and that, you know, getting away from the regular bar and club scene seems to be a more positive thing for bands and audiences. What were some of the other like kind of common things that you were finding as you guys were talking to all these people?
Certainly. I definitely remember talking to some folks specifically from Louisville and South Carolina and Mississippi about ways to provide safety and consent in a space. Like if someone's too drunk or if you see someone that might be getting taken advantage of, like how to counteract that in a non-aggressive way, but more of a productive way so that, you know, there's no fights, there's no aggression, but, you know, the person that's like kind of inebriated finds a safe place home. Like we talked about best practices for that. We talked about like why underground spaces support artists a lot more than bars because of like the price points are often like not equitable. We talked about like how community is kind of the foundation for art and music, especially when it comes to touring, because you start to realize the more you travel, well, people might not know each other. We kind of all played at the same spaces, so we have that commonality going on. So there's a lot of like continuing conversations around that. And then also people sharing how their identity has impacted their experiences with music in a positive way. Like we've talked to people from all different backgrounds, not just regionally, but also like demographically speaking, like, you know, non-men, people of different races and things like that. And they talk about like how music is personal and political. So, yeah.
I know a whole lot of people who like, if you presented them with the idea that you're just like, well, you know, these spaces are safer, just, you know, better for people. Some of them would say like, well, I don't see a problem with a club. And those people all look like me. And that's something I thought about. It's like, well, yeah, like if you're, you know, top of the food chain, so to speak, socially, economically, racially, etc., like you would walk into like, you know, a Johnny Brenda's and be like, I don't see a problem with this. And that's not to single out, like, I don't think there's a problem with Johnny Brenda's at all. And I don't, from a going there standpoint, I'm always curious like how one not counters the argument, but like, you know, responds to that when like someone who looks like me says like, well, I don't see a problem with it.
I talk about that a lot in the documentary, to be honest with you. And I talk about why it's important to include people that don't have a space in the table. And my answer really is, you know, if we maintain the status quo, then you're maintaining a line that gets drawn about who gets heard and who doesn't get heard. And these spaces kind of eliminate that line. And what I mean by kind of is we do recognize that we don't have the quote unquote mainstream appeal of like going to a bar and getting sloshed and then taking an Uber home. But we do have the appeal of having different kinds of sound get heard because we recognize that we're different and we're here to hear each other. And the beauty of that and the value of that is different sounds represent different people. And if we do see each other's differences, we come to a better place of understanding, which leads to less conflict, more harmony, and more peace around us as a whole. So.
And I always think too that like some people tend to discount like DIY spaces, art spaces, a lot of times because some of them, you know, don't have bars and there's some of them don't even have alcohol. Like I remember when Ann Thorne had to kind of make that shift where they're just like, before obviously they didn't have a bar because they weren't a bar, but they're like, all right, people can bring their own stuff. Like when you would go to like First Unitarian Church and see a band or something like that, and everyone had their little paper bags and they're wandering around. And then Ann Thorne just axed it because they're just like, no. It's become a problem, not really with our space, but just in general. So we're just going to eliminate this. And I heard a lot of people being like, oh, well, no one's going to go. But I didn't see less people going to those shows. So I, in fact, enjoyed that because I'm just like, gosh, that just makes it so much easier. Just show up and play. Don't worry about, like, all the other stuff. I'm like, and if you absolutely have to go have a drink, then, like, you know, when the show's over, like, you can go somewhere with your friends and like go to a bar. Yeah, there's always going to be people who are going to just have a real hard time with the idea that like going out doesn't also involve like drinking in whatever capacity.
True.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I mean, I do talk about like, you know, being a sober artist briefly in the documentary. And like, I wasn't always like a sober artist. Like I used to be a drinking artist in the most literal sense. And like, to be straight with you, I understand how someone cannot know how to experience a show without drinking. But like, once you get over that hump and you realize like you can have fun without drinking, as the artist, as the attendee, as the organizer, that literally saves a lot of time and resources because no one wants to clean up beer bottles or beer spillage and all that stuff. So yeah.
And it's something that makes you different from the other clubs and the other places too. It's just like, this is places you can go. And some people who are struggling with it or some people who don't want to, you know, engage with it, but you find yourself dragged out to places with your friends all the time. And then like, you're the one person standing around who's like not drinking. So they think like, oh, well, you're not having a good time. If you can just go to a space like you were talking about, that, like it's not even on the table anymore. No one's doing it. And everyone's having a good time.
No, exactly. Exactly.
I had a feeling you would probably touch on that in the documentary a little bit, but I know you don't make everything that you do about that. I know that's just like one aspect of you as an artist right now.
And this is no shade, just for me. And I just never thought like my sobriety is going to define me. Like there's like, we could take like literally like a 5-day episode series about why am I sober, but like, you know, I just never wanted to be that like musician that's like, well, today I have 6 years, 5 months and 24 days, 7 hours and 45 minutes. Retweet me. Cause like that works for some people. But for me, I feel like when I do that, I'm damaging my own sobriety and my own integrity to be accountable. And like, oh, I can see how for other people, it could help other people's accountability. But for me, I look at it like, if I become that artist, and I start getting retweets and notoriety over that, I'm going to have to always look at myself and say, you have to be sober because of those tweets. And I don't want that sort of pressure versus saying like, all right, it's year 7. This was cool. Thank you for all the people that supported me. Keep it pushing. Because like, while I talk about mental health and recovery, I never thought of like giving all the intimate details like on the internet. Because one, I don't want people feeling sorry for me. And two, like, I just look at it like, no one really needs to know about the fact that, like, I used to be the guy that bought 10 burritos for strangers at Chipotle and didn't even talk to them. Or the fact that I got kicked out of a Taco Bell in college. Like, you know, like that. People don't need to know that. I mean, they know now, but
well, now we know.
That is the type of person I was. And yeah, there's nothing motivational about that.
No, it's good that the motivation comes from inside, comes from you, and not from like you sharing it with the world as not a virtue signal, but like,
no, that's exactly
and I'm 100% with you on that. Yeah, I'm 100% with you on that, though. It's like, for some people that works. Some people have to count the days, especially in the beginning sometimes, because like getting that positive feedback if someone's just like, I'm a year sober, and people are just like, good, great. But it's like at some point after that, like, you maybe stop publicly ticking that box all the time while still ticking the box in your head. Like,
and I'd rather just help people accordingly. Like, I personally find it better when, oh, not necessarily better, more enjoyable when I play a set and someone hears a line from one of my lyrics and they tell me their addiction story and then we start bonding. Not so much where it's like, let me take a selfie. I lost 10 pant sizes, which I did, from drinking. Now retweet my body naked. Like I'm not gonna do that. And if that's what helps you, do it. But I just don't. I think that's dangerous territory because sobriety is very ego driven. And I don't mean it in a selfish way. It's like a restoration of the ego. And if you're still trying to be self-seeking when you're trying to get better, then you're due for a relapse. And I don't like that, but that's usually what happens. So yeah.
I absolutely agree with that. If you're constantly looking for validation in the fact that you're sober, at some point, like, it's you're sort of setting yourself up for another fall right there, which is unfortunate because like a lot of people like don't feel good about themselves. They don't feel good about the things around them. And that's why they turn, you know, to these other things to help medicate, just to be like a crutch, like just to kind of get you through the day. So it's like, that's the other thing too, that like, you know, as we get older and we know more people and we see more situations, we realize like not everyone who got sober just because they partied too much. Like some people got sober because they're just like, I was doing this to escape from past trauma, from not dealing with certain things that needed to be dealt with, and not just like, hey, I should stop like going out and partying. It's like, that's another reason to not do it.
True.
But yeah, there's so many reasons that people can decide, you know, I don't want to drink anymore. And the fact that people have to, like, sort of explain themselves sometimes.
And I just wish more people realize this, whether you're creative or not creative, you don't have to explain yourself. And I know sometimes I fall for the trap, but it's like, be the truest version of yourself so that you can give unto others to make the world more whole. That's at least how I feel. So, yeah.
I mean, in the documentary too, and you've just talked, you talk a lot about healing, which I thought was a very cool through line. What kind of healing did you get out of the tour? You don't have to go into specifics, but like when you came out of this tour, obviously you felt better, you felt different than you had before you went on it. And I'm sure that Brianna, the filmmaker, probably also had similar things as well. But when you finished and like came home, did you feel better about anything? Was anything like more clear? Did you just have a different outlook on how you could go forward or things like that?
A lot of healing from a lot of different experiences. And I know it was definitely different for Brianna, and I'll leave that to Brianna to speak about. But like, music for me has always been healing for so many different experiences, like dealing with past trauma from surviving various forms of abuse to, you know, dealing with depression and anxiety, addiction, which we just talked about. You know, loss of family and grieving. But I think this tour was unique in healing because I felt like it was South by Southwest experience part two. Cause like at South by Southwest, I went there with this mindset of I've only played Philly and Jersey, which is like Philly part two. you know, I don't know if I'll ever play anywhere else. Cause that was in 2015. And then I went from attending South by Southwest and like getting a bunch of cards and seeing people like John V and you know, Dan, from the Enquirer, just like a lot of faces. Like I even passively met Waxahachie, just all sorts of people, right? And I felt like at home because I realized like these thoughts I had in my head, I always thought were unique to me. And then when I started meeting other people that had similar thoughts about music and pursuing music, I was like, oh, I'm not alone. And then the tour, I felt like, was an extension of that because not only did I meet like-minded people that I still talk to this day, I also was able to find homes from people that, like, invited me back or still keep in touch with me. And it kind of just served as a place of healing to remind myself that, like, although certain parts of my day slash life do feel very isolating, I'm really not truly alone in this world. And more so, like, I have spaces, places to feel safe and share my story and also hear other people's stories. And I have to remember that. And I was reminded again of that yesterday at Grace Ferry. I was like, man, yeah, how the hell did I end up here playing for like 100 punks? And I'm just like this dude in a dad shirt. Well, I wasn't a dad shirt. I was in a Punk Island shirt, you know, and people are singing along with me, you know, and that's the healing, like realizing that, like, you know, I've had to deal with some difficult things alone. Like I was homeless one time in my life, you know, I've had to, you know, face like the loss of family members alone and things like that. But it's music and the community and hearing my story and also being able to hear other people's stories and uplift each other that really heals me to realize like there's a lot more value to this world than Excel spreadsheets and emails or all the other dry stuff. So, yeah.
And the thing about like these DIY spaces and like these alternative types of venues is that like commerce is not the key thing that's happening. Like it is a thing that is happening. You know, bands are hoping to make a couple bucks. You hope you sell some records. If you said it's like that bar in St. Augustine, you know, they hope that people come in and patronize them so they can continue to be a business. But it's not like the reason we're there, as opposed to like if you go to the Fillmore and just everything in there is about like spend this money, do this here, like consume, consume, consume. And you leave a show at a place like that. Now, that's a 3,000-person capacity venue, too, so how personal can it really feel? But you leave a venue like that being like, okay, I could or could not have been here. Like I went to the show because I wanted to see the thing. You know, I wanted to see the cool thing. But it's like, I could or could not have been here. Like, it didn't really matter. But when you play, like, an art space and there's, like, 40 people there, everyone had to be there. Like, it wouldn't have worked the way that it worked that particular night if every single person was not in that room being a part of it.
That covers the type of shows we were playing. Like, for example, we played at a college art space in Louisville, Kentucky, and the honest theme to the concert was anti-catcalling. It was an anti-catcalling group at the University of Louisville. And, you know, you saw kids from all sorts of college organizations going there. And what was even greater about it is there was no drinking in the space. People drank outside, but like in the space, there were no beer cans flying around. People were just dancing and having fun. And like in between sets, people were sharing, you know, their stories about why catcalling's bad. And then there was a fashion show where every band, including my own, donated some merch to someone, and they had like a little runway fashion show.
I saw a picture of that in that's what that was in the trailer. I couldn't quite see what the shirt was, but like everyone was like modeling the same shirt like turning around. Yeah, oh, that's really cool.
Like, there was just like all sorts of like cool experiences. I even got to meet the lead guitarist of Lucero, which is like a very you know the band, and I got to talk to Brian. He bought some of my merch. And he said something to me that felt so, like, Yoda-esque. And he still talks to me this day, by the way. And he's like, let me ask you something. Do you want to go viral like those youngins, or do you want a career? And, like, that really hit me because he told me about the ebbs and flows of touring and, like, why it's important to go for a career than go for this short-term viral success. So I definitely got a lot of knowledge and healing out of the tour.
That's great advice. So what are you working on right now besides all the music for the documentary?
So other than all the music for the documentary, which involves like, you know, writing loops, writing just like a bass line or a banjo line, et cetera, et cetera. I've been working on commissions for various clients, like writing melody, jingle music, and I'm also working on an album called A Stranger That You've Met Before. That's the working title right now. And I just finished banjo, ukulele, bass, piano, rhythm guitar, acoustic guitar, and we also have some drums done. And now I'm working with Brandon Bauer from Past Life on lead guitar. Aaron Fox and my friend Maya Renfro from DC are going to be doing viol and violin. We're going to get another viola player from Nashville to get on it. And Taylor Kelly, if you're listening, I might ask you to do some horns. I haven't asked her yet. So that's where we're at now. Yeah.
Do you have plans going forward in this year I know you played the show yesterday at Grays Ferry Skate Park, but do you have plans for anything even resembling a tour going forward?
Not in 2021, unless things drastically change. Because I acknowledge that the level of work and effort for this record is like more than I've ever done. Like, for example, everything I just listed to you, like no one's heard me play banjo yet, except for one song. But like, you probably don't even realize it's banjo. But like, all these things are things that I've been learning the past 3 years on top of like years of guitar. So like, this record is like truly different for me. So I want to be able to make sure that record's done sonically and then start touring on that record, whether that means me touring solo, me touring with a small band, things like that. So
you think it's going to be sort of over inundated, like kind of right at the beginning, like as everyone's trying to get back out there?
It could be. And also I want to drop the documentary before I drop the album. So,
oh, sure.
I don't want to confuse people, but, I think it could be because like, you know, My fear is that people are so excited about shows, they forget all the inefficiencies that came along with it. And then, like, once someone finds out that you have a house or that you organize, your email's, like, really flooded. Like, for example, I'm moving to a new house in Brewerytown, and I've been tweeting about this lately. Like, I will have shows, but I'm not, like, really trying to volunteer my email because, like, my email's already flooded as is. But, like, I think people think, oh, because you have a standard Philly house, you're going to be throwing shows. And I was like, truly, what I want to throw is, like, a no drinking, no smoking potluck show where artists can share their songs stripped down and have a conversation. Like, VH1 storytellers, but DIY.
Yeah, and with food.
Yeah, with food. That's, like, my vision. You know,
that's a good vision. I could get down with that. That's, that's all. I like everything that you've just listed.
Yeah, and you're totally invited, of course, but, like, you know, and I'm thinking about doing that like once a month or twice a month. And that's like easy. It's doable. And like, yeah, there's going to be cleanup because like food, but I that's just like something that I want to do. And I've always wanted to do. And I've played shows like that. And I think they're fun.
I'm hoping that like, yeah, on one side of it, I am starting to see some of those inefficiencies and sort of those same old behaviors and same old kind of workflow models that were like a pain in the ass before, and they're going to be a pain in the ass now too. But I am also seeing some really creative, interesting things happening as well. So I feel like for a lot of this, just as with anything, we're going to see some of the same, and then we're going to see some new stuff that is going to work really well. And, you know, that's just, again, it's kind of how it goes.
True. Yeah, like, and I also think, at least for me, and I think this is going to be for a lot of artists, there's going to be this streamless integration of live and digital. Like, for example, I was talking to the guys in Trash Boy. They just played their first in-person show. And they said that, like, they've got, like, two digital shows coming up. I was talking to Kelsey Cork, and, like, the two of us have, like, Brain Fest sponsored by Aaron Fox and Jace. You know, like, we're doing that. But, like, Aaron's got a slew of in-person and digital shows to promote Fuzzy Logic. So it's like, I think that's what that's going to look like, you know? And like, that's an example of me playing again. Like, Aaron and I are homies, like brother and sister. And if Aaron was like, yeah, you want to do a weekend tour? Of course I'll support Aaron on a weekend tour. Cause like, literally, like we're homies, you know what I mean? But I'm not going to go out of my way to tour until I'm done with this record. That's kind of what I'm saying, but you never know what could happen.
I'm glad you're getting all this stuff done.
Thank you.
And I'm glad that you made this documentary. I really look forward to seeing seeing the final version of it. Comes out July 23rd, 27th.
27th.
I don't know why I had the third in my head.
It's all good.
July 27th. I'm so glad you're doing all this stuff. I think the documentary is like a cool new thing for you to do. And you're a guy who, to me, is always doing cool new things.
Thank you. So, I'm doing my best.
Way to go. Thanks so much for talking, man.
Thank you. Anytime.
Well, that's the show for this week. Thank you so much for listening. Thank you, Brian Walker, for talking. Check out his music, adaywithoutlove.com and adaywithoutlove.bandcamp.com. Like I said at the top of the show, he's got a new poetry book out as well called Surviving and Diving. He's a great writer of poetry as well as a writer of songs. And check out that documentary, Safe and Sound. You can get the trailer on YouTube. Whole thing's coming out July 27th. And go to bsproductions.com. That's Brianna Spouse's production company website for more information about the documentary as well. Really, really enjoyed talking to Brian. And it just, when I thought about it later, and it was just sort of the way scheduling worked and the way the calendar sort of laid itself out to both of us, I think it's incredibly appropriate that Brian Walker is episode 201 because, to me, episode 201 coming after 200, where we built up all this anticipation, it was a big show and a big number and a big milestone. And then 201 is about like, all right, well, you got to keep doing the work. And Brian Walker is a guy who just personifies the idea that you have to keep doing the work. So incredibly appropriate that Brian Walker is episode 201. Check out his stuff at all the places I told you. And go to the Friends and Neighbors page, 25oclockpod.com. You can link up with his stuff there as well. I'm going to leave you with a song from him, actually. This is his newest single. He put it out in early May. It's called Vaccine. You can get it at his Bandcamp, but you get to hear it here. So thank you all so much for listening. My name is Dan Drago. It's 25 o'clock, Philadelphia's longest-running music podcast, I think. I'll catch you all next time. Enjoy the song Vaccine from A Day Without Love, Brian Walker, here on 25 o'clock. Till next time, take care of yourselves.
Took a small needle, stung like a beetle. Feel real good, I'm free from evil. Took a small needle, stung like a beetle. Feel real good, I'm no longer feeble. Vaccine, I took a vaccine. Been inside, I've been outside. Wanna go outside, I got nothing to hide. Been inside, I've been outside. I wanna go outside, I got nothing to hide. Vaccine, vaccine, Moderna, Pfizer, Moderna, Pfizer, J&J, let me stay, J&J. A small needle, stung like a beetle. Feel real good, I'm free from evil. Took a small needle, stung like a beetle. Feel real good, I'm no longer feeble.